Thank you for being here this afternoon. For those of you who've been here all day, welcome back. For those of you who've come in just for this, welcome. We've been having a great set of panels. This topic is one that is very important. I know that when I talk to alumni and parents and others around the country, and also talk to people here, the question, one question that I get more than almost anything other is, what's the role of technology in education? And whether it's at Brown, at other institutions of higher education, in high schools, it's something that everybody's very excited about and I think interested in thinking about. So we put together a really terrific panel. Our moderator will introduce them and I will introduce him. We're very fortunate to have Brown alumnus and member of the corporation, Jose Estabil, here, class of 1984. So welcome. And I won't do the long version of his very distinguished bio, but I will say that Jose serves as Director of Entrepreneurship and Innovation for MIT's Skolkovo and Portugal programs. He is helping to launch a new Institute of Science and Technology in Moscow, a school that's the size of Caltech. So education is something he's thought about a lot. He's an innovator and entrepreneur in his own right in the best of Brown tradition. So thank you, Jose, for coming back and doing this, and we're looking forward to the panel. Thanks.
Thank you, Chris. And we are live. So good afternoon. I thought we would start by introducing our distinguished panelists. And then we would go into a prepared comment that each of them have, and then have a little bit of conversation, and then bring everybody else in after that. Immediately to my left is President Lynn Pasquerella. Lynn is a celebrated philosopher, medical ethicist, and is now the president of Mount Holyoke, where she was also an undergraduate. Lynn has a very long resume, which I'm not going to read through here in detail, but she's fought for social justice and access to higher education from the time she was a student in high school and through her years of teaching at URI. And what I particularly want to point out, too, is in addition by demonstrating leadership or life of purpose and focus, Lynn also continues to work outside of the university, promoting women's issues, and is a project leader for a research team with the Africa Center for Engineering Social Solutions, which is working to improve the lives of women in an AIDS-ravaged section of Kenya. Thank you, Lynn, for joining. Immediately next to Lynn is Peter Norvig, Director of Research at Google, and Peter has been there since 2001. Ran their search operations and is now the director of their research efforts. And he was the head computational scientist at NASA before that. Peter also has a number of awards in his distinguished background. And in particular, he's been teaching and has written the definitive textbook on artificial intelligence and was the co-teacher of the first massive online class that registered north of 160,000 students. And I think he brings a perspective that's unique in our discussion today of having walked the walk, not just talking the talk. And he's also, and if you haven't seen this, you should, the author of the Gettysburg PowerPoint presentation, which is quite funny, and is also the author of the world's longest palindromic sentence, which I asked if I could mention. And then Norman Atkins, who's a classmate, class of 84, has a distinguished bio also both in the area of nonprofits, standing up the Robin Hood Foundation with a fellow classmate, David Saltzman, but also as an innovator in education and an entrepreneur in his own right. And Norman founded one of the most successful charter schools in New Jersey that's grown to a group of charter schools that now teaches 10,000 students. That is and I wrote this down and now I can't find it, the Uncommon Schools, where he continues to be board chair and was founder of. And in most recently, Norman launched the Relay Graduate School of Education. Wait a second. Norm, did I get that right?
Yep.
Thank you very much. I had all prepared comments, and I'm just trying to get to the bottom line. It's a graduate school preparing teachers to teach within a charter school context. And recently, and Norman, by the way, started his career as a journalist, like many of the panelists in the prior talk, and has written for New York Times Magazine, New Yorker, Rolling Stone, Parenting, The Washington Post, and my favorite, The Boston Globe. And he has an AB degree from Brown and an MA from Columbia. And so with that, I wanted to invite our panelists to each give an introduction to how they look at the role of technology in changing what's going on inside and out, and inside the classroom, but also bringing out things from outside of the classroom inside. And we did a poll, and we're going to start with Lynn immediately to.
Was I part of this poll? I don't remember.
You draw the short stick.
Certainly, it's no secret that American higher education has been called into question recently, as we have increasing loan burdens at a time when job prospects for college graduates are uncertain. And while experts both inside and outside of the academy disagree about the scope of the problem or its solution, what is clear is that if we hope to meet our nation's historic mission of educating for democracy, we can't continue to have burgeoning loan burdens and to continue to raise tuition. So new technologies, new methods for delivering a curricula that go beyond the traditional residential liberal arts college and university are putting pressure on those of us who are leaders in higher education to articulate in a more compelling way the value added of a college or university education and why it should be so expensive. And the kind of education that is delivered at Mount Holyoke, that's delivered at Brown University, is expensive. So added to that pressure is the pressure coming from the White House and governmental agencies proposing report cards around access and affordability, creating pathways. And Jose mentioned my commitment to social justice. I have, from the time I graduated from Brown, been committed to political scientist Benjamin Barber's notion of colleges and universities as civic missions, where we not only educate people to be free, but we free them to be educable by serving as a visible force in the lives of the most marginalized, disenfranchised members of society. To do that, that requires that educators get outside of the classroom and serve as public intellectuals. So those are the pressures that are brought to bear on leaders in higher education. Those of us who have been privileged to receive a liberal education at a residential college or university understand what it means, that we understand the transformative power of that type of education. We're trained to write, speak, and think with precision, coherence, and clarity, to propose, construct, evaluate arguments, anticipate, and respond to objections. But more importantly, there is a seamless integration of the curricular and co-curricular, such that we have what philosopher Martha Nussbaum, refers to as an education for human development. We gain cultural competence, critically important in a world that is increasingly globally interdependent. We gain practical competence, and we understand through moral imagination what it's like to be in the shoes of another. The learning doesn't stop when you leave the classroom or the laboratory. It continues in the residence halls, when you're out on the quad. It infuses every aspect of a student's life. And yet, there are ways that we can use technology to enhance that education. So, I'm the parent of 23-year-old twins. I think as long as there are 17-year-olds, there will be a place for residential colleges and universities in the country. So I'm certain of that. We're not going to go away. But there are some examples of how it really can enhance liberal education. Let me give just one example. At Mount Holyoke, we have a new program called The Link. We are attempting to link curriculum to career through a four-year programming. First-year seminar with enhanced advising, a sophomore experience that uses e-portfolios and elevator speeches and allows people to identify internship opportunities. We're also providing paid internships with a pre- and post-internship classroom experience, and then in the fourth year, there's a launch. We want to make sure that as we deliver our curriculum, we have not only academics, but embedded practitioners. So if I teach a course in philosophy of law, I want to be teaching it with a lawyer who can do some reality testing to the theory that I'm presenting. One of the courses that's been offered most recently is a course that's team taught by Professor Rogelio Mañana in Spanish and Latina studies, and John Western, who's in international relations. And their students come together from their two different classes. One is a class on the other in media and how marginalized communities around the world are turning to the internet, to other forms of media to do grassroots initiatives. John is looking at human rights in international relations. So they came together and they asked their students to put together websites, podcasts, other forms of media that are multilingual. And they are asked to present as if they are making a plea for funding for an NGO. What we did was created a porous classroom so that when the students were giving their presentations, they were being judged not only by their professors, and then they had a panel of experts I was invited to come in and judge, but we had people from the State Department and CEOs of NGOs coming into the classroom through Skype to give some of that feedback, to do the reality testing. And so the opportunity for not only flipped classrooms, where you have a much more engaged learning environment by using technology before students come to class, but porous classrooms, I think, has potential for changing the way we deliver education, apart from the MOOCs and online courses. So that's just one example of how we can move forward at a liberal arts institution committed to that use of liberal learning for purposeful engagement in the world.
Thank you. Peter.
Okay. Let me try to explain what it's like to teach a class for 100,000 people and why we tried to do that. Now, as a textbook author and as a classroom lecturer in large classes and rooms like this, I felt like I had a chance to give out some information, but it was in a very one-way format. That there can't be a lot of one-on-one interaction in a class with 100 or 200 students. And so paradoxically, I felt like I could do a better job of one-on-one interaction, which we know is the best way to teach, by going online and teaching thousands or 100,000 at a time rather than just a measly 100 at a time. Now, why is that? I think the most important thing is having students do something. So listening is not doing. Reading is not doing. And so we organized our class by saying, I'm not going to lecture. Rather, what I'm going to do is say, what do I want the student to do next? What do I want them to be able to accomplish? And that's what drove the whole class. And I would only, we would record a video or present some material only to help the student get to that next thing that they were going to do. So everything was focused around the student accomplishing something. And I'm only saying something to set it up so that they get to do it. And that way, it's much more two-way, even though it's impersonal. I don't even get to see the students, but we're having more of an interaction, more of a back and forth. And technology helps us do that. Of course, we can always do it. I mean, the best way to do it is for you and me to sit down on this table and work together, but we can't always afford to have one teacher for each student. So we're using technology to fill in for that. So what did I learn from this experience? I think the first thing I learned is how much more important motivation is rather than information. And you can tell people what you want, all you want, but if they're not ready to receive it, then it doesn't get there. You know, we have nice big libraries here on campus, but if you don't read anything in the library, nothing gets across. And so we had to design everything in terms of how do you keep the students motivated? How do you keep them interested? And a big part of that is making it active, not passive, that they're doing something. And the other part was making it social and not solitary. And there are ways to do that online with discussion groups, with hangouts in video and so on. But I got to agree with Lynn that the best way to do that is for kids to come together. So again, you don't have to worry about the campus going out of business. But maybe we can do better in terms of using the technology And then I think the main reason why I wanted to do this class was to close the feedback loop. And what do I mean by that? Well, let me give you an analogy. So as part of this weekend's festivities, there's an open house in the planetary science department, which they have a great department here. And, you know, and it's amazing what's happened. It only took 50 years from the first launch of a rocket from Dr. Goddard to landing a spacecraft successfully on Mars. So that Viking spacecraft in its navigation was 100 million times more accurate than the first rockets. Now, how did we accomplish that? It wasn't because the rocket engine was 100 million times better. Yes, it was a lot better, but it was the navigation and the feedback. It was building the deep space network, this network of sensors that could tell exactly where the spacecraft was. And so at every instance, we could tell it, turn right a little bit, turn left a little bit, now you're going to get there. And that's what we need for our students. We need this network of sensors to say, exactly where is my student right now, so I can tell them, this is the best thing for you. You should go in this direction, you could go in that direction. And when we give one exam per semester or a few assignments per semester, we're not getting that level of feedback. But if we're online and we're getting a couple clicks every second, now all of a sudden we've got a lot more data and we've got it over more students. And so the promise is we use that data to understand what students are like, what misconceptions they have, and understand our materials. What's the right intervention if they have this misconception? What teaches them to get to the next step? And if we gather enough data, then we can rapidly improve our materials rather than doing it in this kind of ad hoc way. And that's my hope for using technology.
Thank you, Peter. Norman?
So I graduated in 1984, which leading up to that year was a scary dystopian future. I think in talking to undergraduates here, the four letters M-O-O-C are kind of the new 1984, that there's something kind of forbidding or scary about what it is that we're talking about, that there's something dystopian about the future, and people love Brown and the residential experience here so much that they don't want it to change. And so I think we should sort of stipulate at the beginning of this conversation that we have huge wellsprings of gratitude for Brown and what it's done over the last 250 years, and it should live on for another 250 years doing the same thing that it's been mm-hmm. doing and delivering liberal arts education as well as any other institution in the world. At the same time, when I was here, I had a professor named Reginald Archambault. Anybody know him? He was a philosophy professor who also taught about education, and I remember learning Plato and Dewey and talking about them in connection with the new curriculum about 45 years ago, a huge innovation at Brown. And I think we should think about it in relation to education technology, which is to say that we should be careful not to be utopians, that educational technology is not the harbinger of the millennium. But at the same time, we would be fools to put our heads in the ground and not recognize the huge opportunity of educational technology to improve the educational experience, the teaching and learning experience here at Brown and through Brown for the entire world. Having said that, my immediate recent experience with education technology and with MOOCs is at the Graduate School of Education that we created, Relay, which opened up just a few years ago, where we're teaching about 1,000 graduate students to be fine teachers and school leaders. With a couple of colleagues, we launched a MOOC called How to Teach Character and Create a Positive Classroom. We're in the middle of the course right now, and it's got about 25,000 students, and we are learning a ton from it. I think it's forced us to figure out how to explain psychology, positive psychology, the elements of grit and zest and bringing that into a classroom in a way that is far more powerful than what we've had to do before. And we've reached people all over the world with it. And we've opened up, exposed people to a subject that is new for them. And we've gotten a ton of feedback and positive discourse from this particular experience, and the people who are teaching and organizing it are eager to do a lot more. I suspect that in the future, these MOOCs will get better and better. They will be delivered in such a way that will be highly engaging, and that whether it's Coursera or edX or Brown, a learning management system will be like iTunes, and that undergraduates will be able to take these MOOCs as prerequisites for the real learning and courses that will take place on campuses, and that they will be replacing textbooks and lectures and other experiences that are not nearly as effective. More radically, there is a new institution of higher education that's just about to start called the Minerva Project. Has anybody heard of that? It's founded by a guy named Ben Nelson. It's out in California. Larry Summers, the president of Harvard, I think is on the board of advisors. And they're about to launch this fall with 25 or so students in a pilot. And the proposition there is that the seminar happening in person will be replaced with a seminar online where students from all over the world will be virtually connected in a virtual seminar room where they are learning the humanities at the highest level, engaging in discourse the way they would with the very best professors in a live campus like this, and that the professors will be utilizing a tremendous amount of data about their students, how they learn, what they've learned in the course of delivering the seminar, and will be able to teach even better than they do in a live setting. And it also opens up huge, interesting possibilities in terms of mapping out curricula. A huge potential disruptive technology. I shared it with a couple of undergraduates on my way over here. And at first, they were shocked by the idea. And then they started to muse about the kind of work that's happening in the computer science department here and elsewhere, where people are developing technologies like something called Oculus Rift, a set of goggles that we'll be seeing in the next couple of years, where essentially when you walk into that seminar room with your professor, you feel like you're literally in the room and literally having a conversation with other people at the same time, which opens up the possibility for people in Mumbai and Johannesburg and Stockholm to participate in a conversation at the richest level. I don't know exactly how it's all going to unfold, but it's an incredibly exciting time, and I'm eager for Brown to be a part of it.
Thank you. Thank you, Norman. So there are a few questions that come up, and you hear a topic of what does it mean to be in a classroom? And so, and in particular, if at liberal arts schools like Brown, there's a distinct privilege of being able to come to a residential university, go through experiences. And I wondered if you could comment on, in fact, casting it in economic turn, you know, what the value is of gathering people when, in fact, it appears as if you can take classes remotely. And there's technology that will give you virtual presence in a classroom. So how do you rationalize to some of the future parents of kids that may be going to here later to pay for the kind of yearly tuition and that Brown is demanding? Can you reflect how technology, what is the role of the residential college? And Norman, you want to go first?
Having paid tuition to Brown over the last 8 years for two of my children, I think about this.
I bet twice a year.
And I have to say that I feel like the quality of the education at Brown is stupendous and stupendously valuable, more now than when I was a student, and that my children have gotten a spectacular education, largely for three reasons. One, that the interaction with the faculty, the relationship of not just sitting in a lecture hall, but in the seminar room and in the office hours and walking across the green with your professor And the accessibility of the Brown faculty has been phenomenal. Secondly, the group of students who are gathered here are a dream. And just thinking about my own morning walking across the campus and last night and being together in a social and non-cognitive setting with the students here is incredibly enriching. And what we remember from our Brown experience is very much what's not happening in the classrooms. And then third is just the sensory experience. What it feels like when that sunlight is just hitting you on the green at this particular moment in time, or watching the Frisbee whiz across the green, or what it's like to be arguing in a coffee shop, or to be kind of knee-to-knee with your professor talking through your thesis. These are beautiful experiences. My daughter, Shira, is leading a yoga and meditation group here, which I think has 1,600 students involved. And the experiential education of being together and learning yoga and mindfulness practices is super rich and core to the residential experience, and probably worth the amount of money we spent.
Peter or Lynn?
Yeah, I guess I agree with that. I think what you're paying for is a community, and it's a promise that goes both ways. Brown tells the faculty, come here and you'll have great faculty as colleagues, and you'll have great students to work with. And they tell the students, you'll have great fellow students and great faculty. And that works both ways, and they ratchet each other up. So that the community is the key. To make a community harmonious and bond together, there is some amount of physical co-presence that's important. But I also think there's some amount that's not necessary. And we have students that go abroad for a year or a semester, and they're still part of that community. I know, in my work, we have offices around the country and around the world, and we do some projects with remote people. And it really is a lot easier to do one of those projects with someone you've interacted with in person first. Right, so having that connection in the same place is really key. But once you've built that camaraderie, then it's okay to occasionally say, we're going to interact by email or by video conference. So I think there's a place for campuses for students to come together, but you may see more of them than going apart, going out, spending time abroad, spending time in industry, in internships, and so on, and maybe not having to have all 4 years on campus.
I mentioned earlier that seamless integration of the curricular and co-curricular, the fact that we live in a globally interdependent world. There is such a rich environment here in terms of diversity of perspectives that we would lose a great deal if we didn't have this residential experience. And I had similar experiences to Peter and Norman in terms of leaving class in the philosophy department and then going over to have lunch with one of my professors or a group of students where we would speak German because I was doing my dissertation on an Austrian philosopher, and we would go to the CI, and I remember very distinctly the night that John Lennon was shot, being on Thayer Street with my fellow students talking about really deconstructing our society, but many of them weren't from the United States, and so that perspective was invaluable, and I remember it all of these years later because it was a transformative moment. And so that commonality of experience is something that is as significant in educating young people today, or older people, as the demographic of college students changes.
Those are great points. So could you describe briefly what you believe in, say, a 5-10 year horizon, how students will be learning, specifically acquiring knowledge? It sounds like the lecture is dead or will be accessed through a click somewhere. So if you were a student, or have kids my age who will be college age in 10 years, how are they going to go through a typical school day? Care to look at your crystal balls?
Well, I think more than ever we need to encourage adaptability, flexibility, at a time when rapidly changing technology is going to mean rapid obsolescence, and when the jobs of the future haven't been invented yet, the best preparation for students in college and universities is to teach them to think critically and to gain those skills of adaptability and flexibility.
Yeah, I think K-12 education is going to change radically, and that technology will allow for much more personalized learning, and that people will be able to find the modality where they learn best, and that, yes, the lecture is dead, RIP, and that we're just gonna disseminate knowledge in much better ways, and that when people come together at the university, they're gonna throw the knowledge into new combinations, which is gonna be exciting, and we're gonna move from just learning the details and figuring out trends and analysis in a much more powerful way. And I believe that the exciting moment here and the challenge is for faculty members to get out of their departments and concentrations and work across fields to remap knowledge and to reconsider how the knowledge will come together for students, especially as they go out to the world, and that the marketplace will start to demand new types of learning on college campuses.
I think Brown has been a real leader in allowing students to choose their own curriculum, and I think that trend will go farther, that right now you choose your curriculum by putting together a menu of courses that are a semester long. Why do we make them a semester long? Well, in part because in the old days you had to stand in line and fill out the forms and so on, and that was tedious, and we didn't want to do that too often. But I think it's easier now to say maybe the units should be much smaller, and maybe we should be combining them. There should be more interdisciplinary aspects to them, and maybe I'm taking now one unit that's going to be 2 weeks long and another one that's going to be 4 weeks long, and I'm fitting that all together. So I think there'll be a lot more flexibility there, and I think it will also be more lifelong, that you come to Brown now for 4 years and then you get a certification that says you never need to learn anything again. Well that doesn't seem quite right? I mean, it seems like we should be tracking our graduates and saying, hey, you know, here's a continuing class that your favorite professor is offering. And by the way, we know that your employer has agreed that they will co-sponsor it. And don't let it stop after 4 years. Mm-hmm. Keep in touch with this community.
And I also want to add that I think there'll be a greater need to emphasize epistemology with access to vast amounts of information. It will be crucially important for students to understand what's good information. How do we evaluate these resources that are available to us?
Just amplifying off of what Peter just said, I was thinking about it. The genius of American education, according to Larry Kremen, who wrote about this, is that it is a popular, and that to think about the degree as the end of education is awfully sad, and that the technology opens up the possibility of continuous education for adults throughout their lives and brings them into contact with the faculty and the students on College Hill.
So I'm going to ask one final question, and I'm going to invite people to come up to ask questions. So if you want to start lining up, you can. And I love this notion of future sources of revenue for the university other than the undergraduate degree or the graduate degrees. And in that context, I'm happy to hear that Google will be a sponsor of some of this activity. But I wonder if you could reflect on how that changes the relationship, particularly in the context you were saying about one-on-one teaching, from a teacher-student relationship, possibly to an author-audience one, which is sort of understood through a commercial prism, right? It has a slightly different aspect to it. And I think the academy in general, I mean, we're rooted in a medieval tradition of learning, right? The Ivy League schools were originally divinity schools, right? To teach people religion or things like that. So I wonder how you see that, how you see that movement, and how you would, as you know, teachers, how if instead what you had were audiences that opted in and out and the like, how does that make you feel? Does it make you want to be open in the classroom and say things, or are you going to be afraid to go on the record because it'll be perpetually, you know, put out there forevermore?
Everybody who's been a professor thinks that we have an audience. Yeah. I mean, I don't think it's going to change that much. And if you teach well, if you engage students mm-hmm. in active learning, then it won't change the nature of this. So we can use the most vibrant vectors available to us to deliver a good liberal arts education. And there are opportunities available to us that we haven't had before. So where I'm located in Western Massachusetts, we're part of the Five College Consortium with UMass, with Amherst College, with Smith College, and with Hampshire. And now we have an opportunity to deliver courses together so that if we have a class of Russian studies and there are three students at Mount Holyoke, we can bring people in from Smith, Hampshire, UMass, Amherst without having them get on the Five College bus. We can deliver the curriculum together, create efficiencies, use technology together in new ways. We have a new project under a Mellon grant for digital humanities. We can link in with the extraordinary library here, John Nicholas Brown. So we have endless opportunities through technology. We shouldn't see it as a huge threat, but a huge opportunity.
I think there is a tendency for technology to unbundle services that have been bundled before. So if you look at the newspaper industry, they had advertising and journalism, and because they had a nice monopoly in advertising, you didn't look too carefully at that. And then when they lost that monopoly on advertising, now all of a sudden they say, well, why are we paying for this journalism stuff? Let's just have one reporter follow Beyonce around and that'll be it. So
if only it were true.
Right. And I think we'll probably see more of that in education, where professors are responsible for teaching and research, and we like that, and we want to continue that, but we may see more specialists of saying, I've got this skill for reaching a large audience, so I'm going to focus more just on teaching. Maybe somebody else focuses more just on research, still take students into the lab, but there may be ways to differentiate that more than we do now.
I was struck by, Jose, by your putting this in somewhat religious terms. Kind of think that that higher ed, elite higher education, is the country's secular church, and that it ends up being a very elite church. So when we were joking about the $60,000 education for our kids, we have to admit that it's incredibly elitist and that the church is closed to the vast majority of young people in the world who want in, and that it should be the responsibility of the higher ed institutions like Brown to be missionaries for education all over the world. And that when I think about Nick Kristof's recent column about how universities and faculty members are sort of living in an ivory tower, now is both the opportunity to expose the bad teaching that goes on in many universities, but also to open up the opportunity for the very best professors to think about how to explain and broadcast and share the message of what they have within their own small classrooms with students in every corner of our planet.
Really good point. So, questions. We start over here.
Sure. So first of all, thank you all for coming to talk to us today. We really appreciate it that we get to learn from your experiences. This is a question for Peter Norvig. As the basically leading research at Google, what technologies do you think are going to kind of revolutionize the future? You have more knowledge into this than most of us do. Kind of wanted to get a little bit of an insight from you as to what specific technologies you think are going to make a big change in the next couple of years.
Okay. It's hard to predict, especially the future. I guess we see the pushing out of computer technology into the world. You know, it used to be your computer was something that sat on a desk. Then we put it into a slightly smaller form that you can put in your backpack. And now it's in the form that you can carry in your pocket or sometimes wear on your face or whatever. And it'll soon be doing more in your car. There'll be ones embedded in the room. You'll have your helicopters that you're flying around. You'll have your home robots that are doing things more for you. So we see this embedding in the world is important. And that changes things because it changes the way you interact. Right? You're not typing at a keyboard. You're speaking. You're gesturing. And so we think that technology has to be more aware of us. Right? In the first years of technology, we had to bend to them. Now, I think technology is going to have to understand how people work better. I think that's the challenge for the coming years.
Any specific technologies that you think are going to make a particular difference as opposed to applications?
I think we are on the verge of a robotics revolution. People like to look at where robotics are today compared to where personal computers were in the past, and I think we're at 1976. So in 1976, you could buy a computer, but it was pretty expensive, so most people bought a kit, and they assembled it themselves, and then they were proud to have it, and they could play games on it, but they couldn't do anything useful. But within 10 years, you could buy a computer that did something useful. And so I think that's where we are, and we'll see what happens in the next 10 years.
Thank you so much.
Question this side.
Hi, I'm Sydney Silverstein. I'm an alumna from the class of 2012. So I think you guys have touched on the fact of how rich it is to be in a residential college system and the academic discussions that go on. And that's probably what I miss most from Brown. But this has also been one of the most eye-opening experiences in terms of diversity that I have ever experienced. And having now moved to Madison, Wisconsin, and not having that diversity, I think there's something lost in that. So as the future of education seems to be moving online, what impact do you think it'll have in terms of diversity and knowledge about diversity? And do you think there's a threat with that, or in terms of the future of our country and how political things go on, or is it something that it'll all be okay?
A, B, or C?
I think it'll all be okay. So we have a project with the State Department to promote women in public service for women around the world. And no matter where you are, Jose mentioned I did work in Africa for 5 summers. The remotest parts of Africa, there are charging stations for access to computer technology for cell phones. And it allows women in these villages to gain access to leadership training online. And so the students on our campus who are interacting with them on a daily basis are learning what it's like in a way that is different from here, but still meets those demands that Norman talked about of serving as public intellectuals to creating pathways for individuals who would not have access to institutions like ours. So I think it'll be okay.
When I look at I'm grateful for the diversity at Brown, but it's not really that diverse relative to wealth, socioeconomic status. And I think about the classrooms that I've been in rural Kenya and South Africa and India, where there are 70 students in a classroom and teachers are absent and unprepared. I am dying for the technology. I am dying for the signal to emit from places like Brown to those particular places, because I think it will increase the diversity. And if the purpose of education is to build a good society, we can't really have a good society until we are essentially in conversation and connected to everybody. And if we can harness technology for that purpose, fantastic. And if it just opens up the chasm even further, then we're in trouble.
I mean, I think I was asking more in terms of racial stereotypes and kind of transcending those.
I think you have a really good point. It takes, at times, looking someone in the eye face to face to truly understand what it's like to be in the shoes of another. Even then, We operate within a white racial frame in our society to a large extent, and so to overcome that takes conversations being at the forefront of public discussion and private debate every single day. So it's hard work and ongoing work, and so we are at risk of sacrificing those important community conversations by alienating, by siloing individuals, by relying on technology, but there are ways to have those conversations brought to bear, and as we're, as Peter says, we'll be able to look people in the eye through this advanced technology.
Yeah. And I think, you know, there have been studies of things like political polarization, that there's this trend now, if you want to, you can only get your news from one side, that's way in one side or the other of the political spectrum. And that does happen to some people. But what they found is that the people that are online the most get the most exposure to the most different types of diversity. And it's not so much what news sites they consume, but it's more everything else. Right, so it's, you know, well, I was really kind of intolerant, but then I'm on this fishing or sewing mailing list, and, you know, there's some person of a different diversity who I never would have thought of, and they're a great person, and that was my first exposure to that, and now I can think of them as being a human being and not just being prejudiced against them. And so the more you have that, the more experience you have, even if you don't live in Providence.
Thank you.
Thank you. Hi, I'm Joan Daigle. I'm an alumna PhD from Brown, and I now teach and dean across campus in a state institution. And my question has to do with the issue of elitism, and specifically about funding. When I listen to you know, all of you speak, I mean, it's wonderful to think about the possibilities of all of these courses and all of this technology. And I'm really excited about all of that. I am not a naysayer by any means. I think these opportunities are fantastic for the future. But I worry about state institutions. And not, state institutions are worried themselves about not being able to compete with this kind of technology and technological revolution, and perhaps being even priced out of education because of it. There's a fear among state institutions that they will actually cease to exist. And I just wonder if you could speak to that and talk about whether those are irrational fears or whether there is something still fundamentally unfair about the whole horizon of funding for these new technologies. Thanks.
Go ahead. Disruptive technology is so scary. And the cost of education has just escalated so high that there is something broken about the model and the cost. And so there's reason to worry, because we do have to figure out how to do it differently and better for the vast majority of folks. I would run to the University of Southern New Hampshire and learn about what they are doing there. I think that Paul LeBlanc, when he got to be president there about 10 years ago, had an institution that was on the verge of bankruptcy and figured out how to remake it, not around Carnegie units, but on competency and mastery, and to start to think about the new utility that the university could play. And I suspect that more institutions will need to think about how to reinvent themselves for a wider swath of students. I think they went from a couple thousand students to now, 30,000 plus.
I think that you have real reason to worry that there's a growing economic segregation in higher education, where one out of two students who begins college with the aspiration of achieving a bachelor's degree drops out. And 50% of college students in the United States are at community colleges. Very few of them, 75%, don't finish. And so we have to look at the realities. When I was teaching at the University of Rhode Island, I began teaching there in 1985. The support from the state was 44%. By the time I left, it was down to 11%. This is 2008. So we have to fund our public institutions of higher education. And it was frustrating when I was at the White House summit with President Paxson, we were elite institutions there. and talk about a report card that isn't necessarily going to impact us severely because we have the resources to provide access. But state institutions who can't fully fund Pell-eligible students, those on Perkins loans, they're at risk because they will be measured and given federal dollars based on the income of their students upon graduation and how many Pell-eligible students they have. So we are at risk of really hurting the institutions that have served us the most and violating our commitment to education as a public good.
If I get out of comment, I worry also. There was a conference held yesterday organized by Associate Provost Lisa Carriaga Lowe, where students were sharing results from their class, looking at what was going on specifically within Asian American communities in the U.S. And it's an interesting story because it shows that despite the model minority myths, about half of the Asian students that are in colleges are not at elite colleges. They are at state schools or what are traditionally community colleges. And so I worry about the access to first-generation students, whom are primarily from families with few resources, about how they will access the skill sets K through 12 to make them competitive students to be able to come to a place like Brown. And if the stats look like that for Asian American students, you sort of realize we have to look deeper into each of the places and be able to provide support.
Well, and if we're really serious about the notion that the whole purpose of higher education is to educate a broader swath of the population and not just the leaders and the elite, then we have to find a way to share that wonderfully innovative technology beyond the elite institutions. I think there need to be partnerships. There need to be something so that that kind of access to that wonderful world is not just shared with the US elite institutions and then with outreach to the rest of the world, but it needs to be shared with the different levels of institutions within the United States.
Thank you. Susan.
Hi, I'm Susan Kaplan, a longtime public school teacher administrator, and I too had Reg Archambault for a course in education. I'm concerned. I've spent a 40-year career in public education, and I'm very concerned about how our troubled K-12 world is going to catch up with the exciting new initiatives that higher ed is espousing and going toward. Our troubled schools, our depressed teachers, our low morale, our reliance on ancient textbooks. What suggestions do you have for the troubled K-12 world to catch up to higher ed? Huge question, but the College Board, as we all noted this week, said the SAT is not a good test, and they're changing it. So is that a step?
The reform of the SAT is a good thing. It was the architect of that is the same person as the architect of Common Core, which are a set of rigorous standards for American education, which is also a good thing for K-12. I think that some of the most exciting work that's happening in educational technology in the K-12 space is happening in those schools and communities that are working with the most underprivileged low-income students. And that in effect, the charter school sector and the reform sector are like the Silicon Valley of public education. And so go out and visit rocket ship schools in San Jose or Summit Public Schools in California or new classrooms in New York and Chicago, and you'll see how technology is becoming way more adaptive and available to help close the achievement gap for low-income kids. And so I think that on a 1 to 10 scale, the quality of the technology and the experience right now is probably a 1.8. So we're early on, and I don't want to sound like a utopian, But I think it's promising, and promising in the service of helping low-income students to achieve at the highest level so that they can come to places of higher education and get a great experience. Right now, the great tragedy in our country is that 75% of affluent students are able to go to and complete college, and for low-income students, it's below 10%. And so this is what we need to work on.
Yeah. Okay. Yes, I would second that to say that, you know, it's so daunting to think about bringing reforms to the K-12 system and fighting state by state and school district by school district. And so I would suggest if you have an idea, try to go outside the system, and going through a charter school is one way to do that, or go direct to the student, you know, something like the Khan Academy, where they started out saying, we're not going to try to integrate with the schools, we're just going to offer something that students can use. And when students found that effective, then some schools came to Khan Academy and said, we want to do a trial, we want to bring you into the classroom. So prove yourself first and then engage with the system.
Khan Academy joined College Board. Mm-hmm.
Can I just say a little bit about that? Sure. I think more than ever we have to partner with K-12 business and industry to create these pathways. And so Brown has a thriving community-based learning program. At Mount Holyoke, we send about 450 students a semester out into the community to partner with the public schools. A lot of that engages students in technology. We have maker spaces that help students learn those hands-on experiences. And then last semester, I taught a course called Philosophy for Children, where we went into the Martin Luther King Jr. Charter School, and our students taught philosophy to second graders. The graduation ceremony was on our campus, and they get a little button that says, I'm a philosopher. But they get to go to our library, they get to go into our bio labs and play with the sea urchins, and then they get to go to the art museum, and they can imagine themselves in a college space. And working with their families to build that social and cultural capital is more important than anything that we do, because access alone isn't sufficient. We have to engender in students and their families a sense that they truly deserve a place in the academy, and that a place like Brown is exactly the right place for them.
Thank you.
Hi, my name is Rebecca Mason.
And excuse me for a moment. This will be the last question, unfortunately. We're running out of time.
My name is Rebecca Mason. I'm a graduate of Mount Holyoke College and a current PhD student in computer science at Brown.
Excellent.
So one area where I'm really excited about the potential for technology in education is for education of students with learning disabilities to be able to individualize, help people learn things in ways that really connect with their style of learning. And I was wondering if there are any ideas or ongoing efforts in this area.
Yeah, you know, I think that's a great application of technology. Part of the problem with if there's learning disabilities is learning at the right pace, and you know, it's hard to keep up with a classroom that's going at a different pace. But with technology, everybody can go at their own pace. So right away, that's a start. Then the next step is how are they cognitively different, and how should material be presented, and how should you interact with them? You know, I talked earlier about trying to have a model of where the student is, so we need specific models of various kinds of disabilities and try to track with that and then come up with the right materials for it. So I think there's a lot of work on it. There's work on accessibility for blind or hearing impaired and getting more of those, getting all types of materials available to them. So there's on work going on, but if you're a PhD student, it's be good thesis topic.
Certainly technology allows for mastery learning getting independent and instantaneous feedback, and so you can have much more practice more readily available to you. And then in dealing with students with physical disabilities or learning differences, we can use that technology to provide access in ways that we never could before.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. Thank you, Lynn, Peter, Norman, for this great panel. And thanks. And I just wanted to close on a metaphor, which is that I hope what you saw here was a little more Brave New World and less 1984. And I do think we're at the steps of an unprecedented revolution in access and learning for higher education. And I invite you to continue the dialogue, but thank you again.
Thank you.